bless you. We'll be praying.
Thank you, Brother McCain. What a real joy it is to be back in Alabama tonight. I was not able to be here last night. As most of you know who were here last night, I had to go back to my church and conduct a funeral. This was the fifth time that I've had to leave a camp meeting and go back home and preach funeral. Last summer, I was in the middle of a Louisiana camp meeting, and a young lady went on to meet the Lord, and I had to leave in the middle of that camp meeting to go back. And 3 weeks later, I was in the South Carolina camp meeting, and her sister died. 36 years old, like twin girls. He's 36, not expected to die. And so I'd leave the South Carolina camp meeting. Then this year, one of the more prominent members of our church passed away. Very large funeral. Had one of my members tell me yesterday afternoon, said, Pastor, said, we got this thing figured out. If we can just live past camp meeting season, we pretty much got it made for the rest of the year. Another one said, Brother Jeff, please don't go away anymore. People are bad about dying around here while you're gone. But I am so pleased that your overseer was so understanding and excusing me. And I thank God for the young evangelist that filled in for me last night. I was talking to my son Todd today. And he said, Dad, said, who filled in for you last night? I said, well, Ray Hughes filled in for me. He said, oh, said, getting pretty big in the church if Ray Hughes has to fill in for you. I really appreciate, I'm so glad Brother Hughes was here. I'm glad he's not here tonight. He makes me nervous when I have to preach in front of him. But I'm delighted that he was here last night and able to share the gospel. And I've heard so many comments about the great message on the coming of the Lord and then his message that he shared here this morning. This has been just a delight for me to have been able to come back to Alabama for the second time and preach a camp meeting. There are a couple things I really like about preaching in Alabama, and not all camp meetings are like this. Number one, you folks are just real good about just staying here till I get finished. And I'm kind of a long-winded preacher. What little bit I've learned about preaching, I learned as a missionary down in the West Indies, where I spent about 10 years of my life, where often if you quit before 2 hours, they think you just give a little talk. And we'll tell you, we enjoyed a little talk tonight, Pastor. But I've had a hard time since I've been back in America learning to get my sermons in the time frame to fit Americans. I remember 1980 when we moved back home from Haiti, and I was doing some mission deputational work, and I was in a church in Georgia on a Sunday morning, and they gave me the service late. It must have been 20 minutes till 12 when the pastor finally turned the service over to me to preach, and I was preaching, and about 25 past 12, I mean, I was just then starting to get eloquent. I mean, the Lord was just beginning to move and bless and anoint, and I didn't notice it, but there was a man there in the service that evidently had a luncheon appointment to meet somebody or just wanted to beat the crowd at the restaurant. And they said he was just fidgeting, he was just twisting and turning. And later on, somebody told me he got to making ugly faces at me. But thank God that I didn't notice that. But along about 20 till 1, this man was just exasperated, and he reached in and took off his watch and held his watch up and just started shaking his watch. Well, I was there to raise mission money. And I thought, well, praise God. God's touched this man's heart, and he's going to give his watch to missions. Don't pull your watch off tonight. You might lose it. I'll come back and get it if you do that. But every night that I have been here, both last time I was here and this time, you've been so patient and kind, as you said, and not been hardly any going in and out. And I really enjoy preaching to people that love the Word. Then secondly, I've appreciated the way that you have an appreciation for the Word of God. There are some places you go where they just don't much care about the Word of the Lord. They just assume you just tell a bunch of stories and shout a little bit. But I love to preach to people that know the Word. I love to preach to people that bring the Word with them, and people that just get thrilled about what God has said in His Word. I remember many years ago when my family and I went to Barbados, West Indies, to take our first mission appointment. I was the pastor of the River Road New Testament Church of God. My family and I were the only white members in that church, a church of about 600 or 700 people, and they loved us and made us feel right at home. But I remember my first night to preach at the River Road New Testament Church of God. When I read my text, they all read the text out loud along with me. And then during the course of the message, when I would quote or read a verse of Scripture, everybody would know it. I mean, they learned Scriptures from the time they were little children. They memorized long passages of Scripture. And any Scripture that I would quote in the course of a message, the whole church would just join right along with me and quote it. I used to try to trick them. I would purposely hunt for obscure passages of Scripture and quote them, but I never was able to fool all of them. There was always a sizable number of our people who were able to quote the verse along with me. I remember one night, however, I was preaching a message, and in the middle of my message, I said something about lying. I don't remember exactly what it was I said about lying, except that I was against it, and I was wrong. But I noticed that night, it was just silent. I mean, when I said it's wrong to tell a lie, I mean, everybody just sat and looked at me, not an amen, and I wondered if I had said something wrong. After the service that night, one of the old elders of our church, Elder Alfred Seeley, a blessed man that's already gone to be with the Lord now, but he came up to me after the service, and he said to me in that West Indian British brogue, he said, "Pastor McDaniel, you are a pretty good preacher." And I said, "Well, thank you, Brother Seeley. Nevertheless," he said, "I have somewhat against you." And I said, "Well, what is it you have against me, Brother Seeley?" He said, "Tonight in the message, Pastor, you said it's wrong to tell a lie." And I said, "Well, I certainly did say it's wrong to tell a lie, and it is wrong to tell a lie, and I'm going to keep preaching that it's wrong to tell a lie." He said, "Pastor, we know that." He said, "But Pastor, there's a lot of good scriptures against lying." And said, "You didn't use no scripture to back up what you had to say." He said, "Pastor McDaniel, from now on, would you try mixing in a little more word with your preaching?" They started getting a whole lot better preaching at the River Road New Testament Church of God. I love to preach to people who enjoy and love the Word of the Lord. Would you stand with me right now? And if you have your Bible, say amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord for that. Turn to John's Gospel, chapter 4, the fourth chapter of John. And we're going to look at a passage of Scripture that is familiar to all of us who are here tonight. And I hope the Lord will help me not to be terribly long with this, but I want to share with you what the Lord has laid on my heart about this wonderful passage of Scripture. John's Gospel, chapter 4, I'm going to begin reading at verse 21. Jesus saith unto her, "Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship you know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." Father, I thank you tonight for another opportunity that you have granted unto me to preach your word. And I just pray that you will anoint me, that you will anoint us together as we look into the holy word of God tonight. I pray that your spirit would take control of this part of our service. And God, as the word is being preached, I pray that you would impart faith to the hearts of every person that hears the word tonight. And I just pray that you will heal the sick. Lord, if there's somebody here tonight that's sick in body, perhaps there's someone that's suffering here right now. I pray, Jesus, that the Holy Spirit would touch them and heal their body. God, set the captive free, and especially, Lord, save lost people. If there's one person in this place that doesn't know Christ as their personal Savior, I ask you to convict their heart, Lord, and let them know how much you love them. Draw them to you, and may they be saved tonight. Grant it, we'll praise you, for it's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated, but tonight please keep your Bible open as we look into the Word of the Lord several more times as we go through the Word of the Lord. Now tonight, for the next few moments, I want to talk to you on this subject. The wonder of worship. The wonder of worship. This text, by the way, has been a familiar text for me to preach from. I preached from it many, many times throughout my ministry. And there are many, many lessons that we can learn. A lot of wonderful truths that the Holy Spirit can impart to us as we hear or as we read this wonderful passage of Scripture about the woman at the well of Sychar who had this great, mighty encounter with the lovely Lord and Savior Jesus Christ so long ago. I think generally, normally, when we read or hear this passage of Scripture, the first truth that comes to our mind is simply this, that Jesus Christ can save anybody. There's nobody who has ever sunk so low in sin that the long hand of mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ could not reach down where they are and pick them up and wash them in the blood of the Lord Jesus. Now, here was a woman who had been married and divorced. and married and divorced. Until she had been married 5 times, I suppose that she had also been divorced 5 times. Anyhow, she was now living with a man that she was not married to. I mean, if this woman was alive today, I'm sure they would give her an Academy Award. She would be a bright star in Hollywood. She probably is not the kind of person that the average pastor would want to have as a member of his church. Yet we learn a wonderful truth here from the Lord Jesus Christ, that he actually and truly went out of his way, took a long, arduous, winding route to go where this woman was because she was there, and he loved her not because of what she was, but because of what he knew he was going to make out of her. And he loved her just exactly like she was, however. And I think it would be good for all of us to take to heart what the Lord did here and understand that with the Lord Jesus Christ, there is no discrimination. I think so often we pastors are guilty of being quite selective about the kinds of people we want to have in our church. You know, we want to have middle-class people in our church, or we have people with money, upstanding, fine people. You look at the kind of people the Lord Jesus Christ went out of his way to find. I mean, he didn't go after the reputable people. He went down after those who were down and out. And that's a wonderful lesson you can learn here from this text. I remember a number of years ago, I pastored a church in Florida. While I was there in Newport Richey, Florida, there was a young man in our church that I think was probably the greatest personal soul winner that I have ever met in my life. I mean, that was his life. He worked on a job as a mobile home salesman, but he won more people to the Lord than he sold mobile homes to. And he got himself involved in a bus ministry we had in our church. As a matter of fact, he started the bus ministry we had in our church, and he was forever bringing the strangest kinds of people to our church. I mean, I learned not to be amazed about the people that he brought. I remember one particular Sunday, Ray Simmons brought a lady to my church. I don't know how I can describe this lady to you except to say that she was just weird. I mean, this was a weird-looking woman. I've never seen anybody in my life that looked like this woman did. And Ray came bringing her to me before church that morning. He said, "Brother McGinnis, I said, want you to meet Mary." I said, "Hello, Mary. How are you doing?" He said, "Brother McGinnis, I bet you can't guess what Mary does for a living." I said, "I don't want to know. Please don't." He said, "No, preacher," said, "you need to know what Mary does for a living." Said, "Mary is a witch." I said, "No, don't call her bad." They said, no, I mean, Pastor, this woman is a real witch. She's a practicing, card-carrying, union member witch, and she really was. But she also was dying of cancer, and he met her out on his bus route and brought her to the house of the Lord, and Jesus gloriously and wondrously saved her and filled that former witch with the Holy Ghost. We went out to her house the next day and burned all of her books on witchcraft. Now, we about got ate up by a demon-possessed dog she had, but God saved the woman. Somebody should have shot the dog. I remember another Sunday, Ray came up to me before I preached. I mean, Sunday school had just ended, and he came to me. He said, "Brother," he said, "there's a woman that I brought on my bus today that needs explaining." I said, "Well, Ray, what do you mean she needs explaining?" He said, "Well," said, "Brother," I said, "this woman here said that she's really not dressed for church." He said, "But I thought I'd better mention to you before you see her." I said, "Well, Ray, how is she dressed?" He said, "Well, before I tell you how she's dressed, let me tell you the circumstances." He said, "Yesterday I went by this mobile home park and I saw some little tricycles and bikes out in front of the trailer, and the new kids were there. And so I went in and I met this woman and asked her if her children could ride our bus. And she said, yes, they'd never been to church, but she would let me take them to church." He said, "Now, preacher," he said, "this morning," said, "I went by that trailer and that woman had those little children all cleaned up and ready to go. And," he said, "I went up to the trailer and I got them and I walked the kids to the bus." He said, "I got on the bus," he said, "I turned and I looked and I saw this forlorn-looking woman standing in the door of the trailer." And he said, "Preacher," he said, "it just seemed like the Holy Ghost told me to go back there and invite her to go with us." And he said, "I did." And she said, "Well, I can't go because I don't have any good clothes to wear to church." And he said, "Ma'am," said, "you don't have to have good clothes to go to our church." He said, "Well, let me at least get on something better than I got on now." He said, "Now, ma'am, our preacher gets real upset when his buses come in late." He said, "Now, it don't matter what you wear." He said, "You come on just like you are. The preacher would be mad if I bring a busload of children in late." And he said, "Brother Nelson," said, she came just like she was." I said, "Well, how was she, Ray? Describe her to me." He said, "Well, Brother Nelson said she don't have on any shoes." I said, "Well, that's all right." I said, "If it'll make her feel better, I'll take my shoes off." He said, "Preacher," he's "more to it, man." He said, "She's not wearing a dress." I said, "Well, you know, I don't mind. She's got slacks on. It's fine." He said, "Preacher," said, not that either. I said, well, what is it, Ray? He said, Pastor said, the woman's got shorts on. I said, how short? He said, short. He said, she's got red short shorts on. He said, she's just wearing the skimpiest little old top you've ever seen. But he said, Brother Ness said, she needs saving. She might get saved today. I said, where is she, Ray? He said, right back there on the back pew. I mean, she just barely got in the door and said, as far away from the front as you possibly could. I didn't know that woman was coming to that day, and the Lord had already laid it on my heart to preach from this text about the woman at the well. And I preached, in fact, I didn't preach very well. There wasn't a great deal of anointing or liberty to preach, but I made my altar call after talking about the woman at the well, and I saw that little scantily clad woman step out from her pew and come and kneel at our altar, and she literally drenched our altar with her tears as she wept and wept and wept. I remember going down and praying with her. And I heard her confess her sins. As a matter of fact, she confessed things that were actually embarrassing for me to hear. I mean, this woman was very bold and very plain. She said, Lord, the time I did this, and she named what she did. I let her pray that way for a while, and finally I stopped her. I said, lady, do you feel like the Lord has saved you? And she said, oh, no, not yet, preacher. I said, well, let me pray with you again. I said, just confess your sins to the Lord, and let's believe God's going to save you. And I prayed for her. She just kept pouring her heart out to the Lord. Finally, I stopped her the second time. I said, now look up here at me. I said, do you believe the Lord has saved you? She said, no, preacher. I said, not yet. I said, why not? You've been praying. She said, oh, preacher, you don't understand. You just don't understand how deep in sin I have lived. She said, Pastor, she said, there's nothing I have not done. She said, I have lived in adultery. She said, I have been a prostitute. She said, each of my children has a different father. She said, I have abandoned children. She said, I have neglected my children. She said, I have abused my children. She said, there's so many things that I've done. I'm sure the Lord hasn't had time to save me yet. I said, let me show you something in God's Word. I opened the Bible. I turned to 1 John 1:9, and I put my finger on the verse. I said, I want you to look what it says. If we can confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I said, did you confess your sins? She said, oh, preacher, every one I could remember. She said, there are too many for me to remember. She said, I've asked the Lord just to lump all those that I've forgotten into one lump and forgive me. I said, if you confess your sin, what did He say He would do? And she said, well, it says right there, He said He would forgive me of all my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I said, according to that, what did God just do? She looked up at me and she said, preacher, He just forgave me, didn't He? I said, yes, He did. She said, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. I believe at that moment God wrote a brand new name down in the Lamb's Book of Life as this woman confessed her sins and Christ came into her life. And I'm glad John chapter 4 is in the Word of the Lord to let us know that we don't need to be selective about the type of people that we bring to our church. God wants us to go get them. I don't care how far down in sin they are. I don't care what they've done. They're worthy of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen. That's a wonderful truth that we find here. However, I'm convinced that that's not the primary truth in this glorious, wonderful chapter. I believe the greatest truth, the reason the story is here, the reason the Holy Spirit inspired John to write about it is to teach us about worship, about why to worship, and about how to worship. And I hope that God will help every one of us here tonight to really worship the Lord. I'm afraid there are many times when we come to His house and we just kind of go through a form and we may call it worship, but we really don't worship the Lord. I'm confident that it is our privilege and our prime duty to worship God. And I hope if you've not already worshiped Him tonight, before you leave this place, you will worship the Lord. Now, as we look at this passage about worship tonight, there are three things I want us to notice and I want us to learn. Number one, we're going to talk about the reasons for worship. The reasons for worship. Now, if God wants us to worship, why? Well, I believe God tells us in His Word why He wants us to worship. As a matter of fact, I believe we ought to have a reason for everything that we do when the body comes together. If you believe that, say amen. Now, maybe you've not seen it. I have seen some of the dumbest things in the world done in church. Some of you have. Well, praise God. I'm glad I'm not the only one that's done that. I mean, things that had no rhyme and reason. I was in a big state meeting not long ago, and they got up and introduced the one who was going to come and introduce the one who was going to do the speaking. I thought, well, what is the purpose of that? There doesn't seem to be any reason for that. I've had preachers tell me to do things in church that made me feel uncomfortable, and I didn't know why I was told to do that. Like, turn around and say to your neighbor, you sure are looking good tonight. Every time they've ever said that to me, I just happen to be seated by the ugliest person in the house. You know, I don't lie, but you know, what's the purpose of all this? You know, I think everything we do when we come together in a meeting like this ought to have a significance and a very good pertinent reason, and it has to glorify and honor and magnify God. As a matter of fact, Lord, as a God, I believe we could cut our service time down a whole lot and have them more powerful if we just cut out the things that have no rhyme nor reason and take it to a place of pure, unadulterated worship where we magnify and glorify that name that Paul says is above all names. Glory to God. I'm still feeling the liberty that I felt around here night before last. I believe God's in this place tonight. If you feel his presence, would you raise your hand and say, God's in this place? Hallelujah. Now there's a reason to say that. Paul said the Lord is at hand. He wants us to make ourselves aware that Jesus is in this place. Well, glory to God. We're going to talk about the reasons for worship. Secondly, we're going to talk about requirements for worship. I don't believe just anybody can worship God. I believe there are a lot of people come to church and they say, I've come to worship, but what they offer to the Lord does not accept it, and sometimes it even is an abomination in the sight of God, and God would just soon you sit down and shut up. Glory to God. I felt some amens. I felt a kickback or two on that one right there too. But some people, God don't want you worshiping, yet there's something else you need to do first. Number one, we're going to talk about the reasons for worship. Number two, we're going to talk about God's requirements for worship. And finally, if we get to the end of this tonight, we're going to talk about some wonderful results of worship. And when God's people learn to worship and do worship the Lord, there's some mighty powerful results that are going to take place. All right, number one, let's talk about the reasons for worship. Look back in verse 23. The number one reason for worshiping God is simply this, that God desires it. Verse 23, but the hour cometh and now is when the true worshiper shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. Now, I don't know if you write in your Bible or not. You ought to if you don't. If you do, you ought to make a big star right next to that verse 23 where it says, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. And understand who it is that we're talking about here. We're talking about the Father of the universe. We're talking about the great creator, the one who made it all, the one that controls our very next heartbeat. It says the Father is seeking such to worship him. There's something that you got and God wants it. There's something that God wants out of you. Are you willing to give God what he wants? Now let me ask you this question tonight. Why do you thank God that created us? I mean, why did God make us in the first place? That's a question I like to ask people. I ask my people at my church that all the time. Why do you think God made you? Almost always they'll pause just a moment and think. They say, oh, we were created, we were made, we were born to serve the Lord. Yeah, somebody wrote a song about that sometime back. Born to serve the Lord. That's why God made us, because God needs servants. Let me tell you something. If all God wants is servants, he can get somebody a whole lot better than you and a whole lot better than me. I mean, if God just wants servants and service, why, he can make angels that can serve him at the speed of light. He can make angels that serve him with increased intelligence, and they're like robots that will never fail him. They will always do his will. No, my friend, God didn't make you to serve him. God made you to glorify him and praise him. That's the reason the Bible tells us that God made us in his likeness and in his image. Friend, there's no angel made in his likeness and his image. We are the offspring of God. We are his own dear children, and he made us that he might love us and that we might love him, that he might come down in the cool of the day and walk with us and talk with us and embrace us, and that we might have glorious, wonderful fellowship with him. Well, glory, hallelujah, hallelujah. And I think it's going to be a great day in the church of God when we learn that praise comes before performance and worship comes before work. And the number one thing that God wants out of his people is that we might worship him. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 22, Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment, that we love God. I believe with all of my heart that it's our responsibility to evangelize the world, but that's not our primary purpose. Our primary purpose is to enter into his courts with singing, to come before his presence with thanksgiving, to say, Lord, I love you. That's a wonderful verse of scripture in Proverbs 23, verse 26, which said, my son, give me thy heart. I mean, we have the idea that God is always asking us to give him things. I mean, if I give to God my money, do I make him any richer? Of course not. When I give to God my strength, do I make him any stronger?
If I give to God my wisdom, do I make him any wiser? If I give to God my puny glory, do I give him more glory? No, my friend. All I have that God wants for me is my love and my adoration and my fellowship. And I have to worship God, number one, because God Almighty desires it. The ruler of the universe says, Larry McDaniel, worship me. And that's my responsibility, and it is yours. Somebody say amen. Number one reason why we ought to worship God is because God desires it. Number two is because God deserves it. God deserves it. You know, the word worship is a wonderful word. It comes from an old English word, worship, which means when you offer worship, you are recognizing the worth of whatever it is that you worship. I wonder tonight, what is he worth to you? Is he really worthy? One day, are you going to take the crown from off of your head and cast at his feet and say, Thou art worthy, O Lord? You see, when we worship God, what we're doing is we're giving a display of what we really think about him. Now, you let me watch you worship in just a little bit. I can tell you about what you think about the Lord Jesus Christ by the way you worship. If you are half-hearted in your worship, it means you don't really think much about God. The great Baptist preacher G. Campbell Morgan said one time that the highest form of blasphemy is lukewarmness. Did you hear that? Lukewarmness is the highest form of blasphemy. I read that some time back and I thought, well, could that be true? When I think about a blasphemous woman like Madeline Murray O'Hare, who crusaded before our courts and got prayer taken out of the schools and Bible reading taken out of the schools, and I've heard her on the Donahue Show and other shows with her mouth spewing out blasphemy, and I think surely that's the worst kind of a blasphemy. But I think I tend now to agree with Dr. Morgan when he said lukewarmness is the highest form of blasphemy. Here's why. Here's a man or a woman that says, I do believe in God. I believe he did what he said he did. I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe he lived. I believe he died on the cross and he raised from the dead, and that he's back with the Father and is coming back again. And though I believe in him, I don't get very excited about him. I don't get real up about him. Folks, I want to talk to you about blasphemy. When you say, I know who he is, but nothing about that moves you toward him. I mean, if you're one of these kind of people that when it comes church time, you come dragging in 15 or 20 minutes late, I think that's going to say something about how you really do feel about the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen. Turn this thing up good and loud, brother. Hallelujah there. I think when you come to church and you don't sing, you know, I can't sing very well. How many here can't sing very well? You know, I am not a great singer, but when I come to the house of the Lord, folks, I want to tell you something. I am going to sing to him. I mean, we come to his house to magnify him and glorify him, and that's my chief responsibility. Here a while back, about 5 years ago, Brother Doug, when I was in England, we came home one Easter and we went to the North Cleveland church, and we were sitting down in front. I had millionaires on both sides of me that day. I mean, fancy dressed people, and it was a dignified service. And Danny Murray was up leading the singing that morning. He got the leading blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. Doug, when I got to the chorus, was said, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. I forgot about the millionaires on both sides of me. I forgot about who's in front of me and who's in back of me. And I got to singing slightly off key and slightly out of rhythm. I was singing to the tops of my voice, and about that time I felt a sharp elbow in my ribs. My wife was standing next to me. I mean, she gave me a jab and it knocked the breath out of me almost. I said, what'd you do that for? She said, you're singing too loud. I said, I ain't singing to you. I'm singing to him. This is my story. This is my song. You see, people come to God's house and they act like they're just absolutely wore out and they won't put forth one effort to sing. Listen, that tells me what you think about the Lord Jesus. That tells me you don't really think he's worthy of your singing. Glory to God. You know, I get a little aggravated, preachers, at some of us sometimes. That when we preach, we want people to shout. Yet when somebody else is preaching, we want to sit like a knot on a log and not... Whoa, hallelujah. I think everybody in the body needs to come together and say, Lord, this one is for you. I'm going to worship you because you desire it, but also because you deserve it. Glory, hallelujah. Well, hallelujah. I believe you believe that tonight. I believe you believe God desires it. Thou art worthy, O Lord. Glory to his name. Number one, reasons for worship. Number two, I want you to notice some requirements for worship. Look again in verse 19. The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. And ye say that in Jerusalem,
Sit down plain in your mind. Worship cannot be localized. This woman had the idea that there was just a certain place and time where you can worship. I mean, she said, hey, your father says it's on that mountain down in Jerusalem. Our father say it's right here. What do you say, Lord? Hey, Jesus said the hour is coming now is when true worshipers going to worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, what the Lord was saying here is you don't have to wait till you get to a certain place and a certain time to worship the Lord. Somebody say amen. You see what we do sometimes on Sunday? We get in our car and we say, well, we're going to a worship service. And hey, well, praise God, I think you ought to go to a worship service. But I want to tell you something. If you wait till you get to the church building to worship, I doubt that you worship when you get there. Somebody say amen. By the way, that's the reason sometimes our services are so dead and dry. You can't get one thing happening because until they get in the building, their mind has been everywhere else. I believe when you hit the floor in the morning, you ought to get up and say, good morning, Lord. How you doing today? This is the day the Lord hath made. I'm going to rejoice and I'm going to be glad in it all day long. But see, we got this misguided idea that God only meets with the church in the church building. But notice, worship cannot be localized. You cannot confine it to a certain place. Now, every now and then, I've got somebody at my church that'll get upset with me for something we do in the building. For example, we have some singers come by. Sometimes they will sell a tape in the building. Sometimes our little Sunshine Avenue singers will sell some brownies out in the foyer to buy them some new uniforms for their choir. And somebody get all bent out of shape and say, you are defiling the temple of God. Now, friend, they don't have a proper understanding about worship nor about the temple. In fact, I had a man come to my church in Florida one time. He only came to my church on Wednesday nights. He went to some independent church on Sundays. He always brought his guitar with him when he came, and he wanted me to ask him to sing, but I never would ask him to sing because he always smelled like Lucky Strikes when he came, and I didn't think he was living right. But I remember one night I was up teaching, and he asked a question around in the middle of the service. I guess it was almost 9 o'clock, and we'd started at 7. He said, preacher said, I want to ask you a question. I said, all right, what is it, Frank? He said, I want to know about my smoking. Said, I've been saved for about 5 years now, and I've tried to quit. I've asked the Lord to take this smoking habit away from me, and I just can't. And said, I know you don't let me sing because I smoke, but I've asked the Lord about it. What do you think about it? If the Lord wanted me not to smoke, wouldn't he just take it away from me? I said, well, let me just ask you a question, Brother Frank. I said, how many cigarettes do you smoke a day? He said, well, said, I guess about 3 packs. Sometimes I smoke 4 packs a day. I said, well, about how often do you have to light one up? He said, well, sometimes I light one with one. And I said, well, what happened if you don't do that? He said, well, I just get nervous. Just get fidgety. He said, I said, well, what happens if you don't light? He said, oh, I can't not light one. He said, I just got the smoke. He said, I believe I'd have a nervous breakdown if I didn't light one up. I said, well, it's almost 9 o'clock. You've been in this house about 2 hours. I said, you got the mare in your pocket. I said, just go ahead and light up. And he said, what do you mean? I said, no, go ahead. He said, no, I ain't going to do that. I said, oh, I don't mind. Go ahead, just get one. I don't want you to have a nervous breakdown here and just have to call the rescue squad to revive you. If you're fixing to have a fit, you just go ahead and light it. He said, no, I'm not going to do that. I said, why? He said, well, this is the house of God. He didn't know it. I backed him in the corner. Oh, hallelujah. I was fixing to nail him. I said, what do you mean? He said, no. I said, preacher, now you know I'm not going. He said, I don't even think about one when I'm in here because this is the house of God. I said, you might just say this is the temple of God. So he said, oh, yes, that's right. I said, this is the temple of God. I said, oh, I got you. What? Know ye not that ye are the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwell in you? Any man will defile this temple, him God will destroy. I said, better you defile this building than to defile this temple. Let me tell you something. This is not the only place to be holy. The old camp meeting tabernacle is not the only place where God can move. Your local church is not the only place where you can worship God. God wants you to worship God every day, every way, everywhere you go. God's there. You can worship him in the on the highway, in your automobile. You can worship him at work. You can worship him in the lunch room at school. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah to his name. Hallelujah. It cannot be localized, but it dare not be formalized. Look at verse 24. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, what does it mean to worship God in spirit and in truth? Now, some people got the idea that you got to get all quiet and what they call real reverent. They believe that reverence and silence are synonymous. They are not, by the way. You got to talk in funeral home tones, sound like you got a church steeple in your throat. I mean, that's what they think, really, worshiping God in spirit and in truth. I'm going to tell you what it is. Number one, worshiping God in spirit is coming to that place where you allow the Holy Spirit in you to generate praise to God. You see, it comes from God, it goes through you, and it goes back to God, to where there is a perpetual flow. The Holy Spirit flows right out of the throne room. It flows right through the temple, which has been sanctified, which has been cleansed by the blood of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit generates that praise that goes back up to God. That's what it means to worship God in the Spirit. Now let me tell you what it means to worship God in truth. Worshiping God in truth is when you come to that place where you're no longer ashamed to let it be known how you really feel about Him. Glory, hallelujah. Did you hear what I said? When you come to the place where you are no longer ashamed to let everybody know how you really feel about Him. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. I love to watch grandparents. We're praying that our daughter will make us a grandparent before long. She hasn't yet, but I get them. When Sister Overseer stood up back there, Sister Ruth stood up holding that baby, I looked here at Brother McCain, and he just beamed. They make fools of themselves. Have you noticed that? Not just all grandparents do that. They'll goo-goo and ga-ga, and they'll pull out pictures and show you that. You know why? Because they're not ashamed of how they feel. I mean, that's offspring. That's flesh and blood. I heard one man, he said if he knew grandchildren could be so sweet, he'd just bypass the children to get right direct to the grandchildren. I mean, they're precious things. Oh, would to God that we could be that way about the Lord Jesus Christ. Glory, hallelujah. That we're not ashamed to let everybody know how we really and truly feel about Him. We'll worship Him wherever we are. Now it's 9 o'clock. Nine done. Just sit tight. Is it all right if I preach on a while? Glory to the name of Jesus. That old boy saved in my ministry in Florida a number of years ago. He came to visit us in Savannah about 2 years ago, 3 years ago. And they were in service, and he testified God had blessed him. God had healed his daughter of leukemia in our ministry many years ago. And old Gary and Lietta Horton, their girl, was there. And we took them out to lunch with our church staff. After we went to Morrison's in the Oglethorpe Mall. And we're on television there, and everybody in town knows who we are and would come by the table and say something to us. And here we were sitting, and we got down to the table and got our food out. And I asked Brother Gary Horton to pray. And he said, all right. And he stood up. And I saw my wife looked at me out of the corner of my eye. He said, let's just all stand. I said, okay. I mean, what do you do? You can't let him out spiritually, you know. So he stood up, and so we just all, he said, let's just all hold hands. So we're talking about in Morrison's in the mall. Listen, he prayed like Elijah on Mount Carmel. Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that our God, he just prayed and raised his hand. Hey, listen. I said, praise God. I don't believe you have to do that. I don't believe you have to make a spectacle of yourself. But I want to tell you something. If you like old Jeremiah and got the Word of God shut up in your bones, if you're so full of God's Holy Spirit that Holy Spirit is generating praise in you, you don't care where you are. You're not ashamed to let everybody know that you're identified with the Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe worship cannot be localized. And at the same time, it dare not be formalized. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Somebody might say, yeah, but Pastor, there ought to be dignity. Some people don't know the difference between dignity and rigor mortis. Praise God. I believe you can shout and praise God and be a dignified child. By God, I've seen my old silverhead mama shout all over the house. Never seen a more dignified sight in all of my life than my mama praising God. Because God has saved her and washed her in His blood and filled her with the Holy Ghost. Saved her children. Put her marriage back together. Had her name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Well, glory, glory, glory to His name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You need to read about worship in the Bible. I'm telling you, worship in the Bible was exuberant. It was marvelous. It was generated by the Holy Spirit. They did it because God desired it. And because God, let me just show you some things in God's Word. Psalm 9 and 2, I love this. He said, I will be glad and rejoice in Thy name. I will sing praises to Thy name. You know, I get amazed at how some people look in church. Look around, see how people are looking. I heard one man said he's seeing better looking faces on bottles of iodine than you see in some church services. I've seen them come in, they look like they're about half mad and backslid. They wouldn't smile. Preacher tell a humorous story, they would crack their face before they smile. He said, I will be glad. Oh, hallelujah. I believe God's people are a glad people. I believe God's people are a joyous people. He said, I will sing praise to thy name. Don't sing a song in your church that don't give glory to God. Quit singing valley songs. Quit singing them old down and out songs. Quit singing them old press along weary pilgrim songs. And start singing praise. God is great and God is good. He's worthy to be praised. Well, hallelujah. Let me give you another one. Psalm 33 and 3. The psalmist said, sing unto him a new song. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Some of you think you can't sing a new song. Glory to God. You know what I do? I make up songs. See, I ain't singing for you. I'm singing for him. And by the way, when you get up to singing, church musicians, he is the audience. This is not the audience out here. Won't you be singing to them? You sing to him. Lord, this is dedicated to the one I love. And he's right there. He's the one that died for me. Hey, I just make up songs when I'm in prayer and sing to him. Let me say, tell you something else he said. He said, sing unto him a new song. Play skillfully with a loud noise. I like that. I like two things there. Number one, I like it because he said, play skillfully. I don't have a great deal of patience that people try to get up and do something for God. And before they do it, they start apologizing because they're going to do it bad. They get up tuning the guitar. Now y'all pray for me. I ain't prepared to do this. And I can't play very well. I can't sing. How would I say, sit down? Hallelujah. Thank God for some Tony Hollies and Devin Stevensons and others who have practiced and learned how to play. And they say, God, I'm going to give to you the very best that I've got. Amen. I heard Barney Hurst's brother Arville told me one time he was preaching a meeting. He was praying for people. And the lady came up and said, Brother Hurst, I want you to pray for me. He said, what do you want? She said, I want you to pray that God will give to me the gift of playing music. And he said, said, there ain't but nine gifts and playing music, not one of them. He said, do you ever think of taking lessons and practicing? Like all the rest of us. Now, I'm not trying to be funny. I'm trying to make a point. We're singing to the King of Glory. We're playing to the King of Glory. I don't believe a preacher ought to come to the pulpit and say, well, I ain't studied and I ain't practiced and I don't know what I'm going to say. Well, sit down. My God, tell me one of the best things some preachers can do is to walk to the pulpit and say, folks, I have nothing to say this morning, and sit down. If you've not practiced, if you've not prayed, if you've not studied, don't try to offer something to God that you wouldn't want to give to your mother-in-law. Hallelujah. Give God the very best that you've got. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Psalm 47, 1 says, clap your hands, all ye people. Do this for me. Go ahead, clap your hands. Go ahead, clap your hands to the Lord. This is to the Lord. This is not to the preacher. This is not to the ministers. This is not to the singers. It's to God. Oh, God, we clap our hands to you. See, I feel the presence of God here. You clap your hands, you worship God, you'll fill the house with His presence and His power. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout aloud with a voice of triumph. Had a woman tell me one time, said, don't be so loud, God's not deaf. I said, yeah, He ain't nervous either. Hallelujah! It's all right to shout aloud. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, it's beautiful when God's people just praise Him. Magnify His name. Well, hallelujah. I'm going to continue. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lift up your hands and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of Glory will come in. Let me give you one more. I'm going to quit here pretty quick. Psalm 149, verse 3. You're going to love this one. Let them praise his name in the dance. Hear what I said? Let them praise his name in the dance. Don't you be criticizing anybody for dancing. My God, it's a beautiful thing when the power of God comes on somebody and they forget how dignified they think they are or where they are, and they begin to dance before the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You might say, Brother McDaniel, well, I can't dance. Hey, folks, it's easy. You just pick up your foot and put it back down. Pick up the other and put it down. For you know what you're dancing before the Lord, as long as it's to give him honor and him glory. By the way, there's something wonderful in 1 Chronicles chapter 15, 2 Samuel chapter 6. Tells the story of King David going down to Gibeah to get the Ark of the Covenant and bring it back to the house of the Lord, to the house of David, where he had made a tent to put it in. Did you ever read that story, how he did it? But he organized that thing. He got 30,000 men. He said, we're going to go get the Ark, which represented the symbol for the presence of God. So why did he need 30,000 men? You know what they were? They were praisers. You know what some of them did? Some of them had trumpets and cornets. They lined the road. As the ark went by, they played. They gave a mighty blast. Skillful players. Men who were trained to blow that thing like Gabriel, like an angel. And they couldn't all blow a trumpet and a cornet. Some of them played harps. They got their harps down. And as the ark came by, they ushered its presence in by strumming on that. Why, some people can't play a trumpet. Some people can't play a harp. Others, he said, take these brass cymbals and put them in your hand. And you clang the cymbals. Now, you know, you got people that don't like cymbals. I got cymbals in my church. We got a set of drums. First of all, it's got cymbals on it. I got a tambourine in my church. Every Sunday morning, I preach to about 1,200 people in my sanctuary. We're on television. It's broadcast in 34 counties. And when we sing, I'm the only person in church that's allowed to play the tambourine, because I play it better than anybody else, Doug. I can't sing, but I can beat the tambourine. I've got some of my members that it plagues them nearly to death. They hide it. Barney, I've had to hunt all over my associate pastor, J. Frank Spivey. Hid my tambourine. I wish I had it. I'd show you. You don't believe I can play it. Hallelujah. My wife is embarrassed. She's humiliated. Why do you beat a tambourine? You're a pastor. Glory, I'm a child of God first. Hallelujah. Jesus told me one day, honey, I like your tambourine beating. Just keep right on playing it. He had some that blew the trumpet, some that played the harp, some had cymbals. They stood alongside the road. You know what others did? They didn't have an ounce of musical ability about them. You know what they did? They stood alongside the road, and as the ark came down, they just said, amen, amen, amen. Now I want you to get this out. Here's the ark coming down the road. Thousands of them blowing trumpets. Thousands of them picking on harps. Thousands of them beating on cymbals. Those with no musical ability, they just said, amen. Say that with me. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. When it was getting close to the house of David, oh, the king saw it. He was overwhelmed. He got out before the ark. He forgot how royal a king he was. He took off his king's robe, and it got out, and the Bible said he danced before the Lord with all of his might. Satarada mahakayata Mosiah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I know what some of you are saying. Some of you dignified folks right now are saying, well, not everybody's going to like it. No, everybody didn't like it then. One woman sitting up in an upstairs window looking out. And there she sees her husband. Fool, look at him. Don't he know that he's the king? Doesn't he understand that we need to be reverent and dignified? Didn't know the meanings of those words. You know what the Bible said? Said she despised him in her heart. He gets home and she said, boy, wasn't the king a pretty sight today? Uncovered yourself before the people. He turned to her and said, woman, you listen to me. I danced not for you, but unto the Lord. You know what he's saying? He's saying, shut up, woman. I'm going to keep dancing. I'm going to keep shouting. God's so good. God's done so much for me. I love him so that I can't be quiet. Don't tell me to sit down. I can't sit down. Don't tell me to shut up. I can't shut up. God shut up her womb. She is barren the rest of her life. Some of you are barren spiritually because you are ashamed to worship God in spirit and in truth. Now I know where you are. Are you one of the trumpet blowers? Do you blow the cornet? Do you play the harp? Are you one of them sweet singers in Israel? Do you play the cymbals or do you just say amen? Are you one that gets out and dances before the Lord? Listen, there ain't but one place left. It's up in that window. And that's where some of you are right now. You just dead and dry. My God. If God wanted us to be Baptists, he wouldn't have poured the Holy Ghost out on us. Thank God for the Baptist, but I'll thank God also for the power of good Holy God, Holy Ghost that he poured out on the church of God. Hallelujah. I'm not ashamed. Stand to your feet all over this auditorium. I'm not going to get to the last point of the message. It's okay. Find a sign of the Holy Ghost. All right, he's saying, stop right here. Got a blessed old man in my church who went to glory about 2 years ago, Brother Wester. Brother Wester, a blessed old man, about 78, 79 years old when the Lord took him home. Boy, I miss him in my church. I miss him bad. When the Holy Ghost would move on Brother Wester, he'd laugh. I'm not talking about some half-wit man. I'm talking about a brilliant man that held down an executive post all of his life, but had an experience with God in love with Jesus. Hallelujah. Blessed man, dignified looking man, snow white hair and a head full of it, dressed, oh, lovely every time I ever saw him. God would begin to move over our church. Didn't matter if television cameras were on. Didn't matter if the mayor was in our church, which he is sometime. God would begin to move. I'd hear old Brother Western, that deep baritone voice of his. Oh, as he would laugh before the Lord, he'd send a thrill over our entire congregation. Hey, let me just give you some results. I'm going to give you 3 points. I'm not going to explain them. The results of real worship, number one, there's a sanctifying result. You know what I mean? I mean, Psalm, he said, that he inhabits the praises of his people. You know who leaves when he enters? Had to be sanctified is to get rid of the devil. When God's people begin to praise him and he fills the house, he fills the temple, the devil says, let me out of here. My God, if I was the devil, I'd hit the door right now. I'd get out of this place because God's in this place. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Sanctifying result. Glory. I'm about to fly away right here, folks. I really am. You see, God knows when we worship him, we become like him. Hear what I said? You know, some people got the idea that God's some kind of egomaniac. God's always telling us, now, brag on me, honey. Tell me how good I am so it'll make me better. Get that idea out of your head. Listen, God's God. God's sovereign and God's holy. If you praise God, you don't make him more God. If you worship God, you do not make him more holy. If you fail to praise God, you don't take away from his holiness. You don't take away from his glory. God is God. Your praise adds not, nor does it detract from him. God is God. Here's what Paul said, 2 Corinthians 3:18. But we also with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of God. Here's what God's saying. I want you to worship me, because when you worship me, you become like me. There's a sanctifying effect, result of worshiping him. He said, worship me that you might be like me. Number two, there's a satisfying result. My God, if you were created to worship God, nothing else will do. Alcohol won't do it. Drugs won't do it. Extramarital affairs won't do it. You'll never be satisfied until you worship him. Then there's a saving result. I said there's a saving result. Somebody said evangelism is better caught than taught. By that I mean when God's people begin to worship God. You know, some people may think we're crazy. But I want to tell you something, when we worship God, that touches sinners. Where's Devin Stevenson? Is he in this room? Devin was here early. He's probably in the balcony somewhere. Devin and his choir came to my church about 3 years ago. We had just started our television ministry. Our church was uptight because we had TV cameras. In our Sunday morning service, we do. They'd tightened up on me. They wouldn't say amen. They wouldn't say praise God. Devin and his choir from Summerton came. Robbie, you were there. You remember it. They sang. And as they sang, my people sat and looked at them. And all of a sudden, the power of God began to fall on those people from Summerton, Alabama. One of them run out of the choir. I thought he was going to break his neck as he went over the platform. But he didn't. All of a sudden, my people began to worship God. I got a dear little lady named Sister Ruby Donaldson, one of the sweetest ladies I've ever seen in my life. I saw her get out in the aisle and begin to dance round and around. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. TV cameras just kept on rolling. The director sent word out to the platform, said, Brother Daniel, what do I do? I said, keep it going. My God, this is what the world needs. I want them to see this. We had an old-fashioned outpouring of God's Holy Ghost that Sunday morning. I had a banker get saved. I had a lawyer get saved that morning. We had people that saw it on television the next week. They come right into our church. You know what God taught me? God taught me that what we got is what the world needs. My God, this thing was born in the fires of revival. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, the devil can't put this out if you don't want him to put it out. Don't you be ashamed of Pentecostal worship. Don't you be ashamed to shout. Don't you be ashamed to dance before the Lord. I pray for those who are bound by sin tonight that you will loose them and let them go. God, I pray for those who are bound by sickness tonight. I speak healing in the name of Jesus. I pray for divine healing on sick bodies. God, I pray for that one that's discouraged and depressed tonight, that the Holy Spirit would touch them. Let the flow surge through them tonight. In Jesus' name I pray. Now look up here at me. Every one of you will say, Pastor McDaniel, I've got a real need from God, something only God can do. Would you raise your hand, hold it up high? Now, don't just lightly put your hand up. You've got a real need, something you can't do for yourself, something only God can do. I want to ask you to do something. Would you do something for me? Nobody's going to be listening. Keep your hand up. I want you to confess that need to him right now. Just tell him what it is. Go ahead right now. Father, here's my need. Tell him. Would you just tell him? See, he said, let your request